Thanks for joining us today. We are looking at what I think is one of the greatest chapters in the Bible, and it reflects God's character. I'm going to read several verses and then we'll talk about them. Verse 1, Hosea chapter 11. When Israel was a child, I loved him, and out of Egypt I called my son. The more I called them, the more they went from me. Boy, I can apply that to me, I'm sorry to say. They kept sacrificing to the Baals, a substitute for God, offering incense to idols. Yet it was I who taught Ephraim, the northern kingdom, to walk. I took them up in my arms, but they didn't know that I healed them. Wow. I led them with cords of human kindness, with bands of love. I was like to those who lift infants to their cheeks. I bent down to them and fed them. Talk about a picture of God's love. But, he says, they'll return to Egypt, and Assyria shall be their king, because they have refused to return to me. After all of God's love and his care, they have refused to return from me. Sword rages in their cities. It consumes their oracle priests and devours because of their schemes. My people are bent away from, bent on turning away from me. To the Most High they call. He doesn't raise them up. Oh, I have to read a little bit further. It looks like God is going to just wipe out his people. Rudy, a couple of days ago, gave us the small numbers of Israel left on the face of the earth. And it's small. But God says in verse 8, how can I give you up, O Ephraim? How can I hand you over, O Israel? How can I make you like Adamah? Or how can I treat you like Zeboim? My heart recoils within me. My compassion grows warm and tender. I will not execute my fierce anger. I will not again destroy Ephraim. For I am God and no mortal, the Holy One in your midst, and I will not come in wrath. Now, I've read a lot of verses because I wanted to get the whole picture in there. Rudy, why don't you kind of share some of your thoughts on that passage?
Well, God basically lays out the case why we should not be in his presence. But yet he says, how can I do that? Because I loved him. I love you, not right. Loved, but still loved.
Right.
I will not destroy Ephraim, for I am God and not a man.
Yeah.
Then I go back, I think about in the first verses of this chapter, when Israel was a child, I loved him, and out of Egypt I called my son. And so, as I was thinking about increase, in the last few days, it's like, well, okay. Basically, after Joseph had been in Egypt for 17 years, mm-hmm. he became the viceroy of Egypt.
Mm-hmm.
And then 17 years after the famines and all of that was going on, he brought his father and all of his brothers and their children, their wives, back to Egypt.
Mm-hmm.
And the Bible says that when you put all of these people together, it's 70 people.
Yeah.
Well, 400 years later, it's 2.5 million.
Yeah. Right.
And so it just... God says, yet it was I who taught Ephraim to walk. I took him by their arms, but they did not know that I healed them.
Yeah.
In the increase in population, the increase of people, of which Egypt noticed, they are more than us.
Right.
And basically we need to subdue them or they'll basically become our enemy.
Right.
So that's just another vision of God's increase.
Yeah.
But it was for his purposes because, oh, I think as we study the prophets and we see our lives in how our lives parallel what Israel was always doing. We have to see that Israel is a sign of what walking away from God looks like.
Yeah, it's true. When I look at this, I take it personally, and then I also think about the magnificent character of God. And I think this pictures that just like off the chart. So I think about the times that God has carried me, looked after me, and I didn't even know it. And, you know, the first thought that comes to my mind is I fell asleep driving into New Orleans, crossing the twin bridges heading into New Orleans. And I was woke up passing a car doing 80 miles an hour asleep. And man, I woke up and I said, Lord, I'll never do this again. How he has looked after me one time after another and cared for me. And yet, how I have at times refused to return to him. I've said, you know, Lord, I got this. I know better how to run my life than you, and this sin I want to commit is more important than obeying you.
Or have I done that?
Yeah, me too. And so I'm just sharing my sin to maybe there's other company with us. And then he comes down and he talks about, I can't give you up. I can't hand you over. And then I love this. I am God, I'm not a human. He does not have our characteristics. And so he's more powerful than us, he's wiser than us, he knows everything, he's everywhere present, he has all of these big titles. That's not what he uses to define himself. How does God define himself? I am holy and I will not wreck your life. I'm going to come in grace towards you. That's what defines him. His love and his grace, his holiness, his righteousness, those inherent characteristics that he's calling us to have. So righteousness, so justice. I will rain my righteousness and my justice upon you. That's what he's like. And he calls us to be like him. And where do we most see that? We most see that on the cross, where human beings did the worst thing possible they could do to God, which is put him on the cross. And there he says, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing.
Yeah,
pray for us, Rudy, would you?
Father, sometimes I do take that seriously, that I do not know what I'm doing. Mm-hmm. Father, you're the only one that does. Father, help us to see you like that.
Mm-hmm.
That you loved us so much that you died for us. Help us to sacrifice to others in your name, Father, Jesus' name.
Amen. Rudy, thank you so much. Thank you all for just sharing this wonderful passage. Go to Hosea chapter 11. Read it slowly. You'll love it. God bless you. Have a great day. We'll see you tomorrow.